Hello and welcome to Let's Play Dagon DLC. The Little Glass Bottle. My name is Amethyst Lortari. If you're watching this currently, yesterday, and possibly the day before, I played the first the Dagon main game, which the funny thing is that game is free, but the DLCs you pay for, and they're a small amount of money, like $4 or $5 or something like that. But this is a story that is, I believe, about H.P. Lovecraft's first written story that he wrote as a kid, and I've never even read this story from him, so I'm excited to give it a look. The Little Glass Bottle is a short 5 to 10 minute adaptation of a story by Howard Phillips Lovecraft, written when he was about 7 years old. Original words and spelling have been kept. All profits donate to humanitarian aid. Okay. Look for more information.
There's something floating to the leeward.
If I had clicked that, it probably would have brought up a web page. Something floating to the leeward. We can move like on the others. Oh, there's people. We can look all around.
The speaker was a short, stockily built man whose name was William Jones.
Wow. If I was 7 years old, I would have been like, what's stockily?
He was the captain of a small catboat in which he and a party of men were sailing at the time the story opens.
I don't know if we have the trivia here. It doesn't say. I hope I should bother looking for anything.
Aye, aye, sir, answered John Towers, and the boat was brought to a standstill.
So in the original game, there were these little symbols that you click on and gives you trivia about stuff.
Captain Jones reached out his hand for the object, which he now discerned to be a glass bottle. Nothing but a rum flask that the men on the passing boat threw over, he said. But from an impulse of curiosity, he reached out for it.
I'm just looking for trivia.
It was a rum flask, and he was about to throw it away when he noticed a piece of paper in it. He pulled it out, and on it read the following. January 1st, 1864. I am John Jones, who wrote this letter. My ship is fast sinking with the treasure on board. I am where it is marked on the enclosed chart.
Exactly what I would do if my ship was sinking quickly, I'd be writing letters.
Captain Jones turned the sheet over, and the other side was a chart.
Dotted lines represent course we seek, we took.
On the edge were written these words.
He'll read it for me now.
Dotted lines represent course we took. Towers, said Captain Jones excitedly, read this. Towers did as he was directed. I think it would pay to go, said Captain Jones. Do you? Just as you say, replied Towers. We'll charter a schooner this very day, said the excited captain. All right, said Towers.
You still have the zoom in feature.
So they hired a boat.
Because that boat? Oh, there it is! There is! Childhood games. One of Lovecraft's favorite children's games was creating complex scenes using building blocks, models, tin soldiers, and clods of earth. With their help, he played out various historical scenarios. These events were sometimes short-lived. They represented a war, a plague, or simply a thrilling spectacle of travel, commerce, or some event that led nowhere, but sometimes they spanned long eons, reflecting changes in the appearance of the landscape or buildings. H.P. Lovecraft to J. Vernon Shea, November 8, 1933. Oh, this is like right before he died. It is especially interesting considering his later writing career. There was a kind of intoxication in being lord of a visible world, albeit a miniature one, and determining the flow of its events. It was not his only childhood pastime. He enjoyed riding a bike he received for his 10th birthday so much that years later he described himself from that period as a veritable bicycle centaur. Ha! I like it. Any other hidden things? I get stuck between, like, wanting to catch everything and, like, not wanting to bore you guys to tears searching endlessly. That might be it, I don't know.
And started off governed by the dotted lines of the chart.
Governed. Such a jolly adventure. So much different from the actual Dagon game. Fascination with science. H.P. Lovecraft learned to read at the age of 4. Wow. He quickly became interested in exact sciences, especially chemistry. As a 9-year-old, he even started publishing his own amateur magazine, the Scientific Gazette, and doing time, and sometime later, the series The Chemistry. Around 1900, the future master of horror developed an interest in Antarctica and began writing treatises on expeditions to the continent. This undoubtedly influenced one of his famous works, At the Mountains of Madness, written 30 years later. As a 12-year-old, Lovecraft experienced astronomy, which he later considered his most moving experience. Realizing the immensity of the cosmos had a huge impact on his worldview and work, laying the foundations for the cosmic horror genre. The majesty of the concept of an expanding universe will still makes me shudder in a unique manner. A Confession of Unfaith, 1922. Yeah, I thought H.P. Lovecraft died in 1937. Okay. Alright, so ultimately going there. Let's see if there's anything else to see. Apparently not.
In 4 weeks, they reached the place where directed.
No, this is where they left in the stuff that was grammatically incorrect and stuff. Anything else? No trivia on this page? On this scene?
And the divers went down.
I heard a click. Didn't I? Oh, here it is. Literature. Lovecraft developed an interest in literature at a very young age. One of his first books he read was Grimm's Fairy Tales. A year later, at the age of 5, he discovered the 1001 Nights collection. As a 6-year-old, he came across the darkly atmospheric illustrations by Gustave Dore, or Doré, which made a huge impression on him. At the same age, he became fascinated with Hellenistic myths and began his writing adventure. My attempts to write in verse, the first of which I made at the age of 6, were then in the form of raw, internally rhyming ballads, and I sang about the deeds of gods and heroes, selected letters. However, 2 years later, his literary tastes underwent a key shift. That's when I discovered Edgar Allan Poe, with 3 exclamation marks. It was my downfall. At the age of 8, I saw the blue firmament of Argos and Sicily plunge into the darkness of the miasmatic fumes of the tomb, selected letters. Huh. I'm having a little trouble reading as you guys... I keep hearing the click and I don't know... Yeah, the music is distracting me from my reading. It's like way too energetic and happy sounding. Definitely not what I expect from a Lovecraft adaptation. So he's one of the divers. Trivia down here, not much to look at. Hmm. Grandpa. Whipple Van Buren Phillips. Lovecraft's grandfather was a very important figure in his life, as the writer said himself. My beloved grandfather became the center of my universe. Selected letters. Van Buren Phillips introduced his grandson to various works of art he brought from his travels, exchanged letters with him, and helped him develop his passions. He largely replaced Lovecraft's dead father. Interestingly, he also cured him of his fear of the dark by encouraging him to walk through a series of dark rooms. Young Howard's grandfather was probably the only family member to tell Lovecraft improvised mystery tales, which undoubtedly influenced his later work. Okay. That's it. Nothing else to see. Can't go that way. We can't go full 360 right now. I'm not sure why it switches like that.
And came up with an iron bottle.
Oh, that's the suit taken off. I thought one of them was dead.
They found in it the following lines scribbled on a piece of brown paper.
Wow. Imagine if Lovecraft could see this, right? I mean, back then, the whole idea of a video game was foreign, you know? 1917, or however far back this was. Much less that his work had been adapted into the kind of media that he was never introduced to.
December 3rd, 1880. Dear Searcher, excuse me for the practical joke I have played on you.
It seems you're right to find nothing for your foolish act.
But it serves you right to find nothing for your foolish act.
How cruel.
Well, it does, said Captain Jones. Go on. However, I will defray your expenses to and from the place you found your bomb.
So it's like the guy who's talking to the letter. I mean, I know it was written by a 7-year-old, so... I can't really criticize it, even though I kind of am.
I think it will be $250, so that amount you will find in an iron box.
Well, that was nice of him.
I know where you found the bottle, because I put this bottle here. And the iron box. And then found a good place to put the second bottle.
Who has time to, like, lay all this stuff down that you'd probably never even know it was discovered?
Hoping the enclosed money will defray your expenses, some I close. Anonymous.
Spelled M-U-S. There are a few puzzling elements in a little glass bottle. For example, the number 25.0.00, which is not a typo as this amount appears in the text three times, is not entirely clear why Lovecraft decided to write out the number this way and what he meant by it. While publishers and translators interpret it in various ways, in our opinion, he most likely meant $250, which back then was probably a lot of money. The map used in the game replicates the original version drawn by Lovecraft for the story. Did you notice that the land marked on it is signed as Australia? A-I-L-I-A? A simple typo, or maybe young Howard was already creating his own lands and unknown islands in his imagination? Then he'd make it a different word than that, I'm sure, if that was the case. It is also publishing that the dates in the letters in both bottles are almost 17 years apart. Well, now I'm not the only one criticizing this story.
"I'd like to kick his head off," said Captain Jones. "Here, diver, go and get the $250.
Oh, we're going back down now? Anything else? Any more hints? Or trivia, rather? Well, we come right to it this time. Oh, here it is. Oh, here one is. Abdul Al-Hazred. The Mad Abdul Al-Hazred, yeah. Influenced by 1001 Nights, Lovecraft started using the pseudonym Abdul Al-Hazred and persuaded his mother to take him to all the Oriental curio shops and fit him up in an Arabian corner in his room. H.P. Lovecraft to Robert E. Howard, 16th January 1932. It is not entirely certain whether the pseudonym was created by the young writer himself or invented by the family lawyer Albert A. Baker. I didn't know he used it as a pseudonym. I thought it was a character in one of his stories, really. The name Abdul Al-Hazred is certainly very well known to lovers of the Cthulhu mythology. Nicknamed the Mad Arab, Abdul was the author of the Necronomicon, the infamous forbidden book of secret knowledge, and has been mentioned by Lovecraft in various works. Later, Howard became very fascinated by ancient Rome, which resulted in the adoption of another nickname at the age of 7, L. Valerius Messala, which he used during games. Huh. Yeah, that's what I thought. I didn't know he used it as a pseudonym. I thought it was just he talked about him in his stories and mentioned him sometimes. That'd be it, right? Nothing else?
In a minute, the diver came up bearing an iron box.
He sure did. There's a very tight angle here. Nothing to do.
Inside it was found $250.
And what? Gold doubloons?
It defrayed their expenses. But I hardly think that they will ever go to a mysterious place as directed by a mysterious bottle.
Well, enjoyed. This one was shorter. Let's see if something shows up on the main menu overlaid, like at the end of the Dagon game it's off. Oh, that's right. We got the trivia. We can unlock. Alright. I'm doing it for you guys. Getting rid of, or disabling my achievements. The Birth of the Writer. Howard Phillips Lovecraft was born on August 20th, 1890 at 9 a.m. in Providence, Rhode Island. The exact date when the little glass bottle was written is unknown. Young Howard probably penned it in 1896 or 1897. It was first published more than 20 years after his death as part of the anthology The Shuttered Room and Other Pieces, 1959. Lovecraft himself regarded The Little Glass Bottle as a youthful attempt at a humorous story. H.P. Lovecraft to Reinhard Kleiner, 16th November 1916. Scans of the handwritten original can be viewed in the digital repository of the Brown University in Providence. Family legend. There is an interesting legend about one of the offshoots of the Lovecraft lineage, the Musgraves. They were in possession of a 14th century chalice, most likely from Syria or Egypt, called the Luck of Edenhall. Legend has it that the goblet belonged to some fairies who happily drank from it at the St. Cuthbert's Well. St. Cuthbert is a deity you can worship in Dungeons and Dragons, I think. Forgotten Realms? St. Cuthbert? When curious people suddenly appeared there, the fairies escaped, abandoning the goblet. Then one of them shouted out a warning, "If this cup should break or fall, farewell the luck of Edenhall." Fortunately, the chalice survived, and you could still admire it in the V&A Museum in London. This legend has been reappearing in pop culture over the years, ranging from an old German ballad through the name of a pop rock band to manga. Oh, I've heard of the band The Musgraves, actually. And that's it. So that was a cool story. Not really a scary story. Sorry. It's supposed to be scary for Halloween. But I had to play it because it's one of the two story DLCs for this game. But next time will be the Railway Horror DLC, so that'll be showing up tomorrow. And thanks so much for watching, guys, and happy Halloween. Always, seek adventure.